yourself in time. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's so good to be here with you today on this spring Sunday morning. How wonderful. Now, last night we were at the closing night of Sherry's play, The Drowsy Chaperone, and Madeline was with us, and she had been in the play in high school. And she was a wonderful illustration of what it is to be a child of light last night, because she was so excited to see this being done again and remembered so much about it from when she was there. She just about glowed in her seat. And it was infectious. It got to the people around her, boyfriend Seth on one side and me on the other, and it was quite an exciting evening, and it was a nice illustration of what we're going to talk about today. So welcome. I'm glad you're here, and I hope I can turn up my light a little bit and be infectious as well. We're continuing our Lenten journey. We're heading for Jerusalem and the cross, and we're going to Jesus. And we reflect at this time upon who we are. We repent for our errors. We sacrifice our time and our effort and our prayer in doing this. And the letter to the Ephesians helps us to throw some light on who we have been and who we will be, with lots of exciting possibilities. As Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that. The Ephesians were being reminded of where they had been. Before coming to Christ, they were people of darkness. For once you were darkness, not you lived in darkness, not darkness surrounded you, but you were darkness yourself. You were the very embodiment of it. And in the Bible, what is meant by darkness is ignorance and folly, the squelching of prophetic revelations, shouting them down. Lies and the loss of God's truth, impurity and lust, greed, obscenity and vulgarisms, divisions amongst the people, alienation from God, hard-heartedness, and all manner of misdeeds that stem from these miserable lives that people were leading in that inky, inky darkness. And darkness ran with bad company. It gets up to all sorts of mischief without light to expose it. And it's referred to as unfruitful works there in the letter. As Manfred Brock wrote, that old life left people broken, sin-scarred wrecks. They were divided, pitted against each other, blinded against God's truth, accomplishing nothing good for anyone. They were truly involved in unfruitful works. And this passage, dealing with the contrast between light and darkness, has long been given a dark interpretation, especially of the part that reads, "Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them, for it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible." While the ultimate purpose of the letter was to create a new, vibrant, unified community of Jews and Gentiles, the passage has long been used to divide people into us and them camps. Instead, there's been a stain of darkness over the message. When the passage was used to reinforce a sense of self-righteous division between those who were churched and those who were unchurched, those who led and those who followed, instead of creating unity. It's also been misused to congratulate church communities, as if the individuals in those communities have managed all by themselves to move from darkness into light, by the sweat off the brow and their determination of will, all by themselves. We'll return to this. Temptation has been long amongst us to replace God with human achievement. Even today, this continues. And added to this long history has been a trend towards church gloominess, a darkness of character. You see, back generations and ages before, going all the way back to the Middle Ages, the church and the state were pretty much one. There was a source of power to be reckoned with. And joy and laughter were seen as subversive or rebellious to the old order was not to be trusted. You see, a joyous and light-hearted people were a people that thought for themselves. This wasn't appreciated. Although Martin Luther would eventually encourage it. Now, it was far easier to control a fearful people. So they used this passage to point out the darkness that they saw in others, both inside and outside the church. And until recently, the church had the clout to manage this. It used to be that people could tell others how they should dress, how they should behave, how they should conform to Christian norms, both inside and outside the church, and that would remain the case until just after the middle of the 20th century. Some feel it still is, and the world tends to move away from it. Henry Nouwen points out that a humorless world powers prefer people who are insecure, fearful, self-deprecating, because they're easily used and manipulated. And I think we've had enough of darkness now. Let's move into the light. As it says in chapter 4 of Ephesians, put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another. Be tender-hearted. Forgive one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Let's turn around. Let's move into light. The Ephesians were reminded that in Christ they had become children of light. And they must live as children of light. Remember, we're children of light because God gifted us with Jesus. We didn't earn it. It was gifted to us by God out of God's love. And Jesus is, as John chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, remind us, all things came into being through him, the Word, Jesus. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome. Come to Christ. The letter says, do what is good and right and true. These are the fruit of light. Claim the gift of light from God and live it. God's light strengthens the children of light. It empowers those who live in it. They are no longer a helpless people. They are not alone. They do not stumble in darkness. They are bound together in a community of light, creating that community out of darkness by God's loving grace and will, where it did not exist before. This is the great gift and work of God through Jesus. They were told to have no part of unfruitful dark works. They won't even mention what they are here. And here's a twist on the old us versus them, call them out and shame them interpretation of exposing the works of darkness. The letter writer is calling the Ephesians to expose them by the actions they choose to take. Not the words they speak, but the actions. They say, walking the walk is much better than just trying to talk. Talk is cheap. But do fruitful work and show people a better way. Early Christian women did this. There were many communities where the Gentile culture around them, the Roman culture around them, would put out unwanted babies in the night, exposed in the cold, and leave them. And these Christian women, nursing mothers, would gather them up, take them into the homes where they were warm, and they would feed them. They would care for them, and they would come out in the daytime, and they would sit beneath the Roman idols, and they would feed those children and show them that the way of Christ was the way of life, not the way of some cold idol, but the living Son of God. And they grew their community. People were drawn to them by this better way that they showed. Doing the right thing, being light for the people. Such actions empowered by God's gift of light and accompanying strength, let the children of light declare through their actions, sleeper awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. It is a wonderfully optimistic, joyous statement. Awake, arise. Shine. This is a great, empowering, inclusive message to the Ephesian Christians that they could share with all through their fruitful works of light. Manfred Brock reminds that Paul often declared that people who inherited the kingdom of God are those whose lives have been scarred by sin, whose scarred lives have been healed and cleansed by God's grace, who reject the continuing sly approaches of darkness and sin, moving by the empowered Spirit of God who transforms them into images of the Creator, following the teachings and examples of Jesus Christ. To be Jesus' children of light, we need to know who we follow. Who it is that we imitate. Christians, the name comes from little Christs. It's first used derogatorily, but we accepted it. Yes, we want to be little Christs. We want to be Christ-like. And I would suggest that we should turn away from some of the more dour interpretations that have been gifted to us in centuries past, where they would ominously declare, it says in the Bible that Jesus wept. It never said that he laughed, so don't. Which is a misunderstanding of some of the parable uses where exaggeration plays a good part. It would have originally been considered quite humorous. But we tended to lose that interpretation when laughter and mirth was seen as potential rebellion. But James Martin, who wrote a wonderful book called Between Heaven and Mirth, which I highly recommend, states, when I imagine Jesus, it's not simply as a person who heals the sick, raises the dead, stills the storms, and preaches the good news. It's also as a man of great goodwill and compassion, with a zest for life, someone unafraid of controversy, free to be who he knows himself to be, and brimming with a generous good humor, full of high spirits, fun, playful. This helps us define the works of life, the joy involved in it. It keeps us from darkness. James Martin also says, and when you're deadly serious, you're seriously dead. A better goal for believers is to be joyfully alive. If joy is an obvious outgrowth of a life-giving faith, why does it seem absent in so many religious settings? Why do church services seem so devoid of humor? Why are religious people so often characterized as gloomy? The letter to the Ephesians' goal was to create a new and unified community, a growing, healthy, loving, light-filled, forgiving, joyful community. And it is ours for the taking. It is ours as well. There are people desperately needing this message who are living under darkness. And to reach them, it involves reaching out to each other in here and out into our community and discovering what each other can do for each other as children of light. How we can work together showing the actions of light and the good fruit that comes from it in contrast with dark unfruitfulness. It means changing how we've operated sometimes, which is worrisome to people who are averse to change. But we are in good hands. God has a long history of creating amazing change. God led the Israelites with Moses out of slavery. Although some fearful of the change thought, maybe we should go back. Well, they were in the wilderness, but they were let out. And then God sent Jesus into the world and changed all of human history forever. So, God's a bit of an expert on this subject of change. God loves change. And we should trust God as we need to change. We need to believe in God, accept the gift of light, offer it to others in our actions, and grow a loving community. I saw a recent news report in which a bus driver in the Midwest did exactly that. It was midnight, and she was driving her route, and she saw a small child running down the sidewalk. This is a Midwestern winter night. It's cold. The child has a t-shirt, shorts, and socks on. That's it. Tears streaming down his little face. She pulls the bus over, scoops him up, brings him inside, sits him down near the bus heater, says, "Are you warm enough?" He says, "No, I'm still cold." She takes her coat and wraps it around him before she calls the police. This was an action of light on a night of darkness. Now, there was no terrible backstory behind this child. This was simply a young child who'd woken up in the middle of the night when everybody was asleep, decided to get up and play, and had managed to get the door open and gone outside and gotten lost. That was it. If that bus driver hadn't done that action of light, there would have been a tragedy in the morning. The news would have been far different. That is the fruitful ways that we live as children of light. And one way to encourage the light to grow within us is the practice of the discipline of gratitude. Find one thing to be grateful for today, any day, and thank God for it. And if someone bestowed it upon you, thank them as well. Find a way to thank them. And you'll discover soon enough that when you find one thing in a day, suddenly you'll see a second and a third and a fourth, and it'll just start popping up all around you. Your gratitude will grow, and you will begin to glow. And you'll begin to overflow with that sense of gratitude, and others will see it in you. I'll give you a quick example. I went to the library on Tuesday. The Chester County Library has two for Tuesday. You can get two books on disc for $2.12. Instead of just one, which is every other day of the week. And since I drive a long way back and forth, I'm a much better person if I'm listening to a story on my travels. I'm much more a child of light than if I'm listening to the news. As I'm driving down the road, people around me appreciate the fact that I'm a happier person. But that's not it. But I went up and I had my $2. I didn't have 12 cents, so I put out a third bill, and the woman behind the counter laughed, and she handed me the dollar bill back. I said, "No, we have 12 cents here." And I remembered the business about gratitude, and I felt grateful at that moment for that. I didn't have all that change in my pocket. I thanked her. I thanked her well for that, and she smiled. And I was leaving, and I watched a funny little scene there. There's this big revolving door, a high-tech revolving door that you go, and then there's a little regular old-fashioned door. I go for the regular old-fashioned door because that big revolving door is slow as molasses. And somehow, as a safety feature, if you get too close to that door, it stops dead for a couple of seconds and then picks up again. Like anyone could actually be hit by a door moving that slowly. So I never use that door. And here come a couple behind me. She goes out the little door that I went out. He goes into the big revolving door. Sure enough, he gets halfway through and it stops. And you see the moment of panic on his face. I'm trapped in here forever. And then it starts up again. He gets out. The woman reaches up, grabs him by the arm, leans into him and says, "I beat you," like they were about 10. And it made me laugh. smile, and I'm leaving now smiling, and I come across three people, and each and every one of them look at me and see me smiling away, oh, gratitude all over me for this, and they all smile back. They had no idea what I was smiling about, but it was infectious. It was a moment of light, and I saw how easy it is for it to spread. It's simplicity itself. What a wonderful gift from God that is. And now, I would like you to turn to someone near you. Smile. Just smile right now. Turn to someone. I don't care who you turn to. Three rows back, right next to you, smile. Tell that person you're glad they're here. Tell them God loves them. All right. You have done a fruitful thing. You have claimed the status as children of light. Your actions have exposed the darkness. And you may wake a sleeper today, or tomorrow, or next week. It's wonderful. And so it begins.